Storm clouds gather over Europe. Mistrust and rivalries between realms threaten to break and flood the world in a tide of total war.
Welcome, guys and girls, to our new Let's Play of Medieval 2 Total War. One of the all-time greats of the Total War franchise. This was one of my favorite games when I was a little kid, and it's still really good. Of course, there are now a lot of mods for Medieval 2, which I will be also playing for you guys. But we are going to start with the main Medieval 2 campaign. Of course, I did some handiwork in this game already. But for you guys, I'm going to start a brand new campaign. Walk you through it also a bit, because I know this game very good. And we're going to also have a lot of fun. First of all, we're going to check out the options. Video settings. So mine is of course confessed, but I can click this and then you see everything. VSync actually makes your screen not tear, so that's also good to have it on. And I have everything maxed out because I have quite a good rig to run it, but if you're running this on a laptop or a basic computer, you could just choose low or medium, but of course in this setting the game looks at its best. So we're gonna play the single player. Grand campaign. You can also do historical battles, which are also very nice and fun. But we are going to do the grand campaign. We want to select long, so we need to take Jerusalem, which is over here. We are mainly gonna do it in a sort of a historical sense. By this I mean we're gonna go on crusades and actually try to take it from the Muslims. And we're gonna try to do it historically. So in this game we have crusades happening. We can elect our own pope. We have cardinals, we have priests we can spawn, and eventually we could have possibly our own pope, which of course makes us very influential. if Scotland attacks England too many times, they may get excommunicated, which means they are not no more supported by the Catholic Church, and you can just freely attack them as you want. They are basically seen as rebels or heretics or anything else. But the Catholic Church mainly wants Catholic countries. They don't want them to fight. If you fight each other, you get less favor or less high of a standing with the church, with the Papal States, of course. Papal States has its own army, but I rarely have seen them do anything. They just guard the capital, basically Rome. They guard. We, of course, are not gonna play this. Definitely not this. Venice is interesting because they have some interesting units. But we are gonna play, of course, England. Why? Because I love the English-speaking countries. I love the English. And also mainly it's a good starter for anyone who starts to play this game. They have very good archers, they are very strong positioned. Basically when you conquer the island of Britain and Ireland, when you conquer Scotland, basically it's one big island, but it's divided into Britain, Scotland and the Irish. The Irish don't have a faction, they are just rebels. Wales is also not represented. It's also seen as a rebel state, which I would have liked, because it's interesting to have an Irish faction, of course. Interesting to have a Welsh faction. We have the Scottish, which is nice. So yeah. England in this era, basically England is born out of a is basically born out of the Normans. Basically the Vikings conquered this and they started to ravage the French, and eventually this became quite powerful and they started to conquer this. Here we have the Saxons, and they took it from the Saxons. Basically, it's English is basically Viking mixed with French and also the native people of England. The Scottish, however, are more of a pure blood race, I would believe. And of course, the Irish are also not so mixed in blood. I mean, all right. So, as the lore goes, we now own a piece of France, because basically this used to be one big country, but it got divided. I think it's two brothers or two guys that didn't get along. Split up into France and England, but England actually has it. Like the England we play now in this era has its origins in the French. It used to be a part of France. It used to be basically one big country. It actually stretched all the way over here, like this also, and this also used to be English. Of course, the French took it back. This is our last. We're actually in a tipping point, I guess, because the French already took this and this, and we still have this left. All right, that's as much history. Well, I know more history, but that's as much. That's the history I'm gonna tell right now. I'm gonna read out, of course, this for you guys. We are playing England, And we're starting England in 1080 AD. Having recently wrestled for control of the English Isles of England, basically, from Saxons, as I told you guys. So this basically was Saxon territory. The Saxons actually originated over here, together with the Franks, and they actually went over here. And it used to be, it used to have Mercia and everything before that, and yeah, it's also the Vikings came also, but the Vikings they never conquered this. They did conquer a part of it, but not fully. Basically they stopped here. They made here their camp, and they became part of the whole country, basically. Yeah, that this is the Normans. Normans also conquered Sicily, if I am not mistaken. Yeah, they're very very hardy bunch, very very strong. All right, let's continue our read. Many would expect the conquering Normans to be somewhat spent and weakened by their conquests, of course, by their taking the land of the Saxons. They lost a lot of men, and this is why they are weakened. However, the new rulers of England have swiftly replaced and improved the taxation system, and so as to replenish their coffers in quick time. Alright, so they reformed their taxation. They basically found a way to make more money, which in turn brings more soldiers, I can imagine. Alright, where were we? Okay. William the Conqueror came with the support of the Pope. Alright, so the Pope backed him up, as well as a mixed force of well-trained infantry, archers, and heavy cav. Alright, yeah, okay, their infantry is good. It's quite good. Their archers are superb. They have one of the best archers in the game, especially longbows, as you can see here in this picture. They're very nice. I believe if you play like what is it, the mod for this, the Third Age, I believe they took a longbowman for the Dunedainian Dunedainian archers. They are also very, very good. Alright, I am spinning off. The Third Age will come, but not now. First we're gonna do the main Medieval 2 campaign. Alright. Yeah. So, archers and heavy cavalry. Yeah, cavalry is also quite good. England's new masters have a more modern approach to the art of warfare and the will to utilize the country's rich resources to its maximum effect. Yeah, England has quite a few resources to exploit, actually. Court may now speak French. Yes, of course they speak French, because basically they used to be a part of France. France used to be all this. Yeah, but France worked in an interesting way. It had a lord, a king basically, but everything was governed by, well, they had a lot of power, the barons, I would call them the overlords of the regions, and they were also continuously fighting for control. So yeah, I guess this part could have been in that some year having a lord, and then he conquered this and then was stronger, and yeah, it was a continuous power struggle, and out of this actually became England, because they grew very strong in power, because the Normans were quite good warriors. They had Viking blood, they had they were a mix of everything, basically. They were a mix of Viking, mix of French, also some Saxon blood, I think, and some English, native English blood. So yeah, very, very strong breeds. All right, let's read this out. So, the English court may now speak French, but the Normans certainly don't consider their new conquests of a French territory. Alright, let's do that again. But the Normans certainly don't consider their new conquest of a French territory. Alright, this independence in England, plus the proximity of Normandy to the other lands, the French monarchy considering their own. All right. So makes French an immediate and obvious threat to deal with. Yes. Okay. Yes. Definitely. France is definitely a threat. The ever stubborn Scottish also prevent the King of England from having uncontested control of the British Isles. Yeah, this is a well-known fact and a well-known struggle all out through the history of England and Scotland. They were continuously fighting and killing each other. So let's continue. Basically, the English wanted to control, the Scottish didn't want to bow down. So, quite a hardy bunch, also Scottish. I also would love to play them. I could if I unlocked all the factions, but we're just gonna do it. We could modify the game files and unlock the all factions. But that would be cheating. But actually the game intends, if you like destroy a faction, you can play it. So if you destroy the Scottish, we can play a new campaign playing as the Scottish, which is nice. So let's continue our read. Though they presently face trouble on multiple fronts, yes, of course, on Scottish, on French, maybe the Vikings also will. Spain also is quite a threat, also, actually. Yeah, it's a lot of threats. The English are in a rather promising position. The Scots to the north are isolated from the rest of Europe and should be easy to wear down with a strong ally from the mainland. Alright, that's just... Should be easy to wear down without... Oh yeah, without. Yeah, I was thinking with... No. Without, so yeah. Basically, they want to tell us... it would be really bad for England if the Scottish and the French got an alliance and basically teamed up against England. That would be a really bad case or scenario, so we have to prevent that at all costs. But I'm not gonna push too hard on the Scottish, because I kinda like it. They did kind of survive. They were never actually conquered, I believe, throughout history. So, it's more fun if you keep them alive, you know. You have these battles you can defend against them. I quite like it that way. Alright, also you have a spoiler alert, but you have William Wallace actually also in the game. Yeah. If you have seen the movies, it's also very nice to defend against him. Yeah, he basically brings a big horde of Scottish infantry and basically everything. And he tries to invade England, and you have to defend against him, so it's nice. Alright, where was I? The French royal forces are more than a match for the armies of... The French royal forces are more than a match for the armies in Normandy. But they also have enough fronts to deal with. Yeah. Right now. And... they are unlikely to be able to drive them from the continent anytime soon. So yeah, the French at this time or in this map have currently this. And this is all rebels, So Bruges, I think we have Bruges Antwerp here. And here we have, I think it's Bruges here, and here we have Antwerp. So yeah. So this is not... I don't believe the country of Flanders actually existed in this time, so it's just considered as rebels. Would have been nice if this was implemented also. There are quite a lot of factions. This wasn't a country at the time, but like Ireland, I think, was a country, and Wales. Welsh also was a country, I believe. I'm not sure. But I feel like there is some smaller countries or smaller factions missing. For me, the more factions, the more fun, basically. So, yeah. Alright. So, I think that's basically everything. So, yeah, here we have the Normans. So, the French, basically, I was talking. So, they have a lot to deal with. This is the only Roman Empire. This is... Italy, and we have Spain. Spain is very likely to ally with French, with the France, but they also have some guys. This is Portugal, and this is the Moorish, which is now Morocco, I believe. Yeah, the Moorish. And here we have, I believe, Egypt. Yeah, we have Egypt, and here we have, this is basically all rebels, I believe. Here we have the Turkish, here we have Greece. Sicily, I think this is Russia. We also have Hungary in the game, and I believe Lithuania or Poland over here, something. Yeah, alright. So, some more advice on this. So, here also, we can select our difficulty. So, if you are like a really good player, you have to set it on very hard. Basically, it's meant to be played on very hard, but you can go for easy or medium or hard, but I always play on very hard. Otherwise, it's no fun. It's just too easy for me. I just steamroll over the map, and I don't find it very immersive this way. Alright, so I like things the hard way. So, difficulty. This is the main difficulty. So, our enemies will get more funding. They will basically get more money to build faster and bigger armies. Alright, so battle difficulty. This affects, I believe, morale in all. That's the biggest effect. I don't believe it affects fighting capabilities as much. In other Total War games it does, but I don't think in this one it does. I think it just that the enemy holds longer before they break or run. Yeah, and basically like if you play Warhammer, for example, if you play in a legendary, the the lowliest of enemies will be like very, very hard to beat. So all decent, at least decent. Not hard, just decent. Yeah, so that's the difference with Medieval 2. And I believe it only affects Moral. Alright, so we're gonna set this, of course, also on very hard. No battle time limit, and I believe in the time when they were fighting, they also didn't have a clock that basically, oh no, we have to stop fighting, you know. No, it wasn't. It was they fought until the last man. So we are going to do the same. No battle time limit. We're not gonna manage all cities, because if you click this, basically, so if you click this, if you unclick this, you will have, I think, 60 minutes, and then whoever is, or if they take need to take settlement, for example, you have 60 minutes to take it, or if you're defending, you have 60 minutes to keep it, and if the timer runs out, you basically win, or have a draw at least. If you click it, you'll have to fight until the very last man. Alright, and this is more nice, I believe. If you want your cities to be auto-managed, by all means do it, but the AI will spend your coin. You can adjust it, but again, it's more nice if you can build what you want yourself. So we're not gonna manage it. Yeah, we're gonna show the moves of the AI. Definitely want to see what they are doing. Yeah, it of course takes a bit more, a bit longer, because they are moving around and the camera is actually looking for them, but yeah, I want to see what they're doing. Alright, so our objective is that we hold 45 regions, including Jerusalem. So we have to push over here, we have to, we can basically go wherever we want. But yeah, all right here you can set your advice level for you guys. I am going to set it to tell me everything, so you learn also from the advice. It's very helpful. Of course, for me it isn't, because I kind of know everything, so it's more nice for you guys, I believe. Alright, so now we are going to get started. To get started, you just click this whenever you are ready. Be sure to click the wall victory. And of course, if you want to do the same as me, very hard, very hard. And here we go. If you know a lot or more, you can turn it off, or only vital info, but we're gonna do this. So yeah, let's get started.
With the Norman conquest and a crowned king came the dawning of a new era for England. Nobles ordered the construction of mighty castles to fortify the realm. To rule this land is a birthright, but to control it requires the courage and skill few possess. It is a kingdom beset by enemies. The Scots press at its borders, the Vikings to the north, and the French separated by a mere channel of water. All of the country exists in a state of war, as even the common are called upon for duty. In these times of total war, it rests on the shoulders of those who lead to ensure the kingdom does not fall into ruin.
So we have Kane.
The icons under your settlement show the income, loyalty, and growth of the settlement. Icons will also appear if the settlement is close to rioting, under siege, or has the plague. Move your mouse over the icons for more information.
Yeah. So, if you have a settlement, you can see here if the populace is happy and if we have growth. Yeah, we can also click our right mouse button to see some little details. So we have woodland here. So here we can see this is a rebel region, and this region is owned by France. So this is Kane, our castle, basically the birthplace of the where the Normans, and from here they invaded England, and they took this, and they made themselves a king, and we are following up on that. Alright, so some more explanation about settlements. We have castles, and we also have cities. This is the two types we can have. We can have small cities, big cities, however you want it. But for a city to progress, we need to have growth. The more people we have, the more we can expand our city. As you can see, now we have wooden walls. After this comes small. Let's see if we can... Yeah, see, there we go. Now we have a wooden wall, we can upgrade it. Here you can see, you can upgrade it. Okay, let's just get her out of the way. Yeah, so yeah, we get the free upkeep. We get some happiness bonuses and some recruitment, and we get to train Tom Militia, basically town guards. Alright, it's a wooden wall, it's not the best, you know, there are more good walls. Castles, however, first you have the wooden castle. Let me just quickly look if I can find the
If there is no permanent governor in a settlement, it's a good idea to queue the buildings that you want to construct when you have the opportunity. When a general moves into your settlement, you can select the buildings you want to build, and your construction orders will continue to be carried out even after the general has moved on.
Yeah, yeah, that's also a thing. So you can build with or without a general in the settlement. There are some mods out there that make it so you have to have your general inside to actually build, to give the orders, of course. But in the vanilla Medieval 2, you can build, if your army is out there, you can still build things. So yeah, so we click this. Basically, let me do it again. So you click your settlement, Kane, for example. Here you have the stuff that is already built. So we have a garrison quarters, where we can, this is basically where we can recruit infantry. We can recruit peasants, we can recruit spearmen, levy spearmen. We have our castle, of course. From this we can recruit maiden knights and hobblers. These are basically like light calf, and this is heavy calf, not the heaviest, but heavy calf. We have of course extra wall defense, more towers that shoot, better gates, and of course we get to keep our people more in check, and some more recruitment slots. Basically these, the castles are recruitment centers, first and for all, and also bastions of defense. And cities are more of an economical center to make money off. Alright, so this is very good that we have a castle here, because we're gonna be assaulted a lot by the French, so it will help us a lot. Alright, as I wanted to explain to you guys, so this is our castle. Of course, here it's called town. But the army icon, so we can select this, or we can select this. This shows us all. Okay, so this shows us the buildings that are already built, and this shows us our army. Army that is present inside of the castle. Now, here we have the army that is present inside of the town. As you can see here, we have the blue colored cards of the units, and you can also see they have free upkeep. This is what this means is that the units are costing you nothing to maintain for the turn while they are inside of the settlement. Normally the unit would cost us 125, and now this is zero when you have this blue card. You can check if how many units you can have under free upkeep. The number of free units is now currently 3 because of these walls. The better our walls, of course, the more units we get to upkeep for free, which helps out a lot in our economics. Alright, so we now understand that we have, if we click this, we have the buildings that are already built in our castle, and this is our army inside of the settlement. Then we can go over here.
If you move a general into a settlement, he becomes the governor. Generals with high piety, chivalry, or dread make better governors. In the absence of a general, your settlement will be automatically managed.
Yeah, that is true. If you move your general out, you know, it will become like under a steward, and you will have like a growth policy build, tax policy build, and balance policy, and many others. But with our general, normally we can change our tax level, but with this we cannot do it. Normally you can set to high or very high, which brings us, of course, more money. So here we have Robert inside. He has 2 stars for command. The more command he has, the more he inspires our units, which gives us a buff in leadership. Chivalry is also very good to have, and loyalty he can, if this actually becomes 0, he will become a traitor to the realm, and he will take all the units in your army which he has, and he will turn them all into rebels, and he will start fighting you. So we'll try to keep this loyalty up. I guess he loses loyalty when he loses battles, of course. By many other reasons, basically. I don't know the full details of it, but yeah, definitely when he loses a battle, he loses also loyalty. Piety, this is basically how Christian he is, or how saintly, I guess. So yeah, he has all these attributes. Of course, we're gonna try to max them, but it's quite it's not so easy to max them. Also, when you have like when he has like a high chivalry, he will be called Robert the Chivalrous. If he has a lot of threat, Robert the Butcher, or Robert the something else, you know. Yeah, here also the same. The pious, the course of the campaign, we will get some names, some extra titles pop up here. All right, so enough about this. Here we see his age. I believe if they reach like 60 or 70, they die. They don't grow 90 or more. I've rarely seen it. I've never seen it actually, so. Alright, so here we have our statistics of our settlement of Cain. We have a 606 income generated, I suppose, by our port. We will see that later, how it's generated. Our public order is 180, which is very high, very good. It starts to become bad. I guess 100 is also good, but under 70 or 60, they start to get really mad, the populace. So we have to keep it around 100 or more, definitely 180. If I could change the tax rate, of course, I would go up with the tax rate. So anyway, the people are happy, so we can ask more taxes. Yeah, we have population of 1500. Currently, this is growing by 0.5%. Yeah, and here we also see our next upgrade for our castle here is 4,500 people. So it's a long way to go. We can, however, boost this by building some buildings that have this effect. So food will, of course, the more food, the more the people will, the population will grow faster. Yeah, there are some buildings that are like good for economics. Chapel will increase our religion, our Christianity in the region. We can also convert to a town if you want. If you want to change this castle into a town, if you have a strategic or economic advantage to this, you can do it. But in this instance, it's not so good if we do it to a town. We will get more money, but our defenses will be weaker, which in turn will make it easier for France to take this. So yeah, no, what we want to do is not focus on the growth over here. On the first and for all, we want to get our military buildings built. So we have stables. This is for the horses. So when you have, say, basically the basic is hobblers, then we have knights, then we have There are a couple of stables we can build. I will show them here soon in the building browser. I'm gonna explain the basics first. So we have stables, we have military, so infantry line buildings, like the drill square. We already have the garrison quarters. This is tier 1. And we have tier 2, and also we have tier 3. Tier 4, I have to check in the building browser. But if we build this, we can have billmen, which are armor piercing. We have levy spearmen and peasants. Yeah, peasants are not so good, but yeah. Alright, so we have the infantry tier building here. And we also have the bowyer. This is for the archers. We don't, this is tier 1, of course, peasant archers, then eventually we have tier 2, and eventually we will have also access to longbowmen, and that's the ones we want. I think we also have yeomen or something, yeomen archers. Alright, and also, no, so next to bowmen, archers, we also have artillery. Oh yeah, we have catapults, we have ballistas, we have also have trebuchets. Later on, we also have cannons in the game, so it's a lot of fun. yeah, so yeah, of course tier 1 is gonna be ballistas. You can snipe some units with it, you can destroy some gates with it, however you want. Also, always nice to have some artillery in your army if you want to. You can make it also with artillery. You can also assault units or destroy units from afar, so it's really fun to watch. You can also set the arrows ablaze, so fire damage. Yeah. All right. So next to the stables for the horses, for calf, infantry, and archers and artillery, we also have upgrades for our armor. So if we build this leather tanner, we get a armor upgrade on our infantry. And also on our horses. Guess also on our if we have some plate armor, or we can also upgrade our horses. I'm not sure about that, but definitely our infantry and our archers, we can give some more armor, which will make them more durable. Definitely very nice for our infantry. Our main goal is for to upgrade our infantry, but to have more armor on our archers is also quite nice. So yeah, it's a leather tanner. It's basically a not a smith, but a leather worker, and after that we had the, so this is tier 1. We also have 223 for this, which I will show soon here. So we have also this to build, and also we can develop our road system, which will increase our trade, and our, of course our tradable goods, which also will increase our income, and also affect our growth in some way, but not hugely. What will affect our growth is land clearance, which I'm gonna show this first. Alright, so dirt roads, and then as you can see, improved roads and trade. Here we have food. We will also increase our income with this, but also our growth. As I said, the more food, the more people will be fed and less will die, and yeah, that's how we get growth. So our chapel, as you can see, keeps our people happy and converts them also into Christians, which is very good. And we can also recruit a priest, which can deal with heretics, and which will also actively preach in the land, which will give a bonus to conversion to Christianity. Alright, so that's all very nice and very good. Oh, I have wandered off somewhere. Alright, here we go. So, yeah, that's the basics explained. As I said, I'm going to show you now.
This scroll shows you the buildings that are available for construction in cities and castles. You can see the existing buildings in your settlement and what can be constructed. Select a type of building on the right to see what can be constructed for each level of a city or castle. Right-click on a building for a detailed description.
Alright, so here we have it for castles or cities. So as you can see, London now has tier 2, tier 3, tier 4. As you can see, we have more upkeep here, of course more durable walls. Yeah, then this only has 3 upkeep. We have also in our castles, we start with a wooden castle, then we go to an actual castle, then we go to a fortress, which we can recruit this from. These guys dismount from the knights, which are very good, very nice. And also, here we go, dismount English knights, yeah, basically knights that fight. Normal knights fight on horses, but these are like a infantry form of them. They're very very good. They're not good against cav, but against anything else they will do very good. All right. So this is the castles. This is the cities. Yeah, this is basically to show us the same. Alright, it's basically this what you gotta look at. Alright, so we have this to build. We have barracks. In cities, we start off with Town Watch, Town Guard, City Watch, and Military out in Drill Square. Oh, man. In castles, we start off with a mustering field, garrison quarters, Drill Square, which we are going to build now. Armored Swordsman is definitely one, the ones you want. And of course, we have the Armory, which will give us a heavy Billman Armored Swordsman. Yeah. Alright. So, let me also get to build ports for shippies. For ships. Alright. So, ports. Yeah, basically, they are for trading. And we can also have some. We can also have some ships. But they are just. They're not animated or anything, it's just a CGI fight or a however you want to call it. just a auto fight, you know. Yeah. So, yeah, that's that. Alright. Here we have also, it's basically the same. Yeah, we have a lot more to build. We have also sometimes always in citadels we get to build a ballista tower in cities. Actually, it's the maxed out level of a town or a castle. So we get ballista towers, or we got, yeah, it's basically the same. It just looks different. The stables we can only build in. We cannot build in cities, just in castles. So we start off with this, then we go to this. Feudal knights, English knights, and feudal knights. I like barracks. These, as you can remember, are for our infantry. We can build them in cities. Maxed out version gives us militia. Militia is basically town guard. But interestingly, it gives us more control over people, basically. Not a police force, but a guard force, as you will. You can think of it as a police station or something, you know. Yeah, which will give us bonus to law. All right, so that aside, in castles we can also build them. We start off with mustering hall, then we go to garrison quarters, drill square, barracks, and yeah, of course, heavy building and armored swordsman. This I know we already saw, but I'm just going down the line now. So we also get to build archery for archers. In cities we cannot build it because it's basically embedded in the barracks here, the archers. So it's all in one. For castles, they specialize in archers. It's a special building for this. So you have the bowyer practice range, and we get instantly bowmen, longbowmen, which is nice. Here we go, yeoman archers we also have, and here we have the best, the cream of the top of the cream, or however you want to call it. Retinued lumbermen, which are very nice. Alright, so we also have for sieges our artillery cities. Here we go, it's trebuchets. And I believe it's kind of the same. Yeah, it's the same. Smiths, here we go. They are called smiths, however. Alright. Never mind. So, leather tanner. We have light mail. We have heavy mail for the armor. Partial plates. Full plates. And advanced plate. Which will make our infantry, our cav, presumably, and our archers more durable. And I believe it's Yeah, it's both the same. So we can build them in cities and also in castles. Ports, we already have seen. Roads, we have two types of road, paved roads, cobblestone streets, as you will. Farms do have quite a lot of upgrades. Land clearance, communal farming, crop rotation, and irrigation. Yeah. So, which brings us more food, which in turn also brings us more growth. Churches are just this we have, a normal church, and in the castle is, it's a chapel. So, yeah. And in castles we also have a training grounds where we can, like, basically, here we go, free upkeep for units, this is nice. Also we can have some happiness and some experience for knights, so yeah, that's nice. Yeah, of course we also have the guilds. These pop up not randomly, I think. Well, for us it looks quite random, but sometimes you have a message that says this guild is interested in your city, wants to settle there, and then you can accept or not. So yeah, but it's basically the same in cities or castles. They give us more melee attack, more weapon damage. They upgrade our weapons, capable of upgrading, and yeah, it's these are kind of the same. It's just a alright, yeah. So this is nice. Also, this is something that will randomly pop up. Templar knights, which of course we can spawn them or recruit them, which are very good units. Hospitaller knights, we can also recruit when this becomes available in the settlement. And the Woodsman Guild, I guess these are. I guess they are some thieving guild. Yeah, these are Sherwood Archers. Yeah, it's kind of. Gives me like a Robin Hood feel, these guys, but. Yeah, they are. I guess they are a thieving guild. Tolerating this. Yeah, see, they're archers. Alright. So, and that is that. That's the castles. And here we have the cities, which is a lot more. I could go over it if you want. Alright, we'll go over it. This we already know. This we also have seen already. Alright, this one we haven't seen. Military Academy, Demi-Lances. Yeah, they're basically shock cav, I suppose. This we have seen. This we have. Oh, this we have not seen. This is a late tier. This is a. This becomes available at. When we have. Some date or some year. I'm not sure what kind of date, but yeah, guns basically. So guns are a thing in medieval too, in late game of course. Bombard. These are basically artillery basically. Yeah, but they're sweet. Smiths. We also have seen. Ports, alright, and the cities we have very, very big. Oh, okay, this is also a late tier or a late campaign. Or, yeah, this is also nice, which gives us more trade again. This gives us, alright, yeah. and some, basically a jousting or like we had the jousting or training ground for castles. We have this for ships in the for cities. Trade. Oh yeah, this one definitely the grain exchange increases our tradable goods. And we can also recruit merchants. Merchants, we gotta put on a resource, and then they start trading it. And in turn, they gain experience, which gives us more more coin. And merchants also can try to take each other out by destroying the other party its business. And also, he takes the money of them then. So yeah, also very very cool. Roads, also basic roads, dirt roads, and cobblestone streets, farms. We also have seen already mines. We didn't see. So yeah, some regions. It shows zero because we don't have actually. It's settlement or region affected by the region. It also depends what kind of. Ores or deposits there are. So yeah, we have big mines and small mines and big mines. Academia, yeah, all right, again, firearms, so yeah. Churches are quite a lot bigger in a settlement. So we have the small church, we have the basic church, the abbey, we have the cathedral, and we have the huge cathedral, which of course gives us healing, so people can go for basically it's like also serving as a hospital. And of course people become Christian, and also a public order bonus because it's nice to go to the church. We also have inns. This is where we can recruit our spies, also the happiness spies and assassins. So yeah, this is basically the buff or happiness of our settlements. Assassins can kill basically everything. They can kill lords, they can kill priests, spies, other assassins. Yeah, it's a sneaky way to end like a very good lord, but they also can get killed or can get caught. So yeah, the more experience of course they have, the better they are at it. But at any time they can just die. Spies also can get killed, by the way, when infiltrating a settlement or infiltrating an army. They just get caught. If they are lucky, they can run away, but they can also die. So yeah, keep that in mind. Town hall. We also have law and public health, more health and more health. The major's palace, we have city hall and sorcerer's chambers. Town hall. All right, so yeah, we can. The more healthier people are, the more they will. This will also affect growth. They will keep them more alive. Yeah, and also bonus to law. So less thieving, which. Actually, banditry will affect our income if it's a lot of banditry in the region. They basically steal everything and we don't make any money. So it's nice to have a public order bonus to the law, which stops this, which prevents our economy to collapse due to banditry. Yeah, basically you make more money of a settlement because less things get stolen. Alright. And of course health is affecting our growth and also keeping our people I guess also happy, and yeah. Alright, we have the Assassin's Guild. Yeah, I don't have to explain this. it's Assassin's Guilds again, so they pop up randomly. They choose a city anywhere in the world. Sometimes you take a settlement and it has the guild already inside of it. Yeah, so I do believe there is only one headquarters in the game. So one settlement can only have the headquarters. It can have like this a lot of, but the headquarters, it's a one-time thing, you know, or one-time one settlement. It's capped at one basically, to not have it's the headquarters, so it shouldn't only be one. It's normal. All right, so yeah, this is important if you want to have the headquarters. Definitely take it, and let the they will ask then to if you want to build the Master Assassin's Guild, and then you have a chance to become the headquarters of it. It's always nice to have the this one because it's giving more buffs, of course. The Mason's Guild, which also gives us again public order. This also gives us this gives us public order due to the law. All right, and this gives us happiness, which, oh yeah, here we go. We also have some units that we can build off of it. There we go, very nice. So yeah, that's the Mason's Guild headquarters. Technologians Guild. I don't have to introduce that. I think also it doesn't give any buffs, but it's like a big college. Merchants Guild does give us a buff, of course. Trade. Merchant Cav, these are basically traders that have not so much fighting skill, but they have very good armor because they are rich. Of course, they can buy good armor, but they are not so good with the sword because I didn't have the training for it. So yeah, you have also Merchant Cav. We have also the Alchemist Guild, also again a guild, but this is also a late game. Also gunpowder again. And here we have also the next to the Assassin's Guild, we also have the Thieves Guild. Again, it doesn't give any real buffs. Explorer's Guild also doesn't give any buffs. Swordsmith's Guild we already have seen. It's capable of upgrading. Here we have the Temporal Knights headquarters. We could have Hospitaller Knights of Saint John. Also very nice to have. We already have seen that, and we also have the Horse Breeders Guild. Oh yeah, which gives us. When we recruit a calf unit, it gives us a starter experience point of 1. But here we have experience bonus, so I guess it's 1+2 or it's just 2. Yeah, we'll have to see that. So that is this explained. So yeah, I click this and then you go to this. Just to quickly show it. Alright, so in a settlement we also have this button if you want her to talk some more or explain you more stuff. She talks definitely. So she recommends you what to build. We are not gonna ask her this. Go away. Alright, so we don't need her. You may need her, but I don't need her. So we also have this button, show settlement details.
This scroll shows you a breakdown of important factors affecting your settlement.
There she is again.
Move the mouse cursor over each icon to find out more information. Your main aims are to maximize income and growth while keeping public order and religion as high as possible.
Yes, definitely. All right, now it's my turn to explain it. All right, so this is the settlement details tab. As you can see, we have population growth, public order, income, and religion. Here we have what we are trading for, and this is what is actually, this is the negative one, what is actually affecting the negative, and this is what is affecting the positive. So we are 1.5 plus 1.50, so that's 1. Minus 1.5 leaves us 1.5 of growth. If we have more people growing and this is staying the same, we will go into the negative, basically. So, next up is our public order law. This is from our building here. So 50% law, and also armies garrisoned in the settlement.
Left click on a unit to add it to your recruitment queue. The number of units you can recruit each turn depends on the size of your settlement. Right click on a unit to learn more about it. Click the Show Me How button to learn about recruitment.
All right, we will get to that soon. First, we will explain this. All right, so as I was saying, units garrisoned inside of a settlement also give a public order bonus. When they are not on the move, they are patrolling the streets, making sure everything is safe. So yeah, resulting into this. These shields represent this, and these heads with colonial hair, I would like to call it. Yeah. These are represented by this building giving this. No, it's actually not this. Oh, no, it's actually our castle. It's actually our castle. I'm sorry, guys. It's actually our castle giving this public order bonus to the law, which will give us this. Alright, so this is the plus side again. This is a negative unrest. I don't know why they are unrest, but they have 10% who are not happy. And religious unrest, this is basically who are not Christian. They can just sod off. No, they are not gonna sod off. That is very bad. Are not so good, but we have to convert them into Christians, basically, which will happen over time. Of course, if you have a small chapel built or more, or if you have a priest inside of the region, which will also convert the populace. Also, you can have heretics, or you can have imams. Yeah, the Muslim kind of bad boys, right? This will give us. They will actually convert them either into heretics or into Muslims. So get your assassin ready to kill those guys, and heretics can be dealt with by priests themselves, priests or I cannot get to the name, but you also have cardinals. They can be or are in the College of Cardinals. So yeah, we'll talk about that soon. Alright, so that's that. Public order. It has way more icons, but they are not showing now, so we'll see them later on in the episode or in this or in this episode. It might be, if you take a look at the other settlements. Alright, so, income, admin. Alright, we have trade, we have taxes, which gives us a huge amount of coin, and we have our farms, but they are not developed yet, so yeah, if we do this and this will go up basically. Yeah, and we don't have anybody stealing anything, so that's good, because we have a lot of, well, a high presence of, not high, I reckon, it's just, if you compare it to the people, the more people, the more units you will need to keep them all under control, I suppose. Yeah, that's the word I am searching for. Alright, so we have this income, and we also have a religion in detail, so we have this religious unrest, and this is caused by pagans, nonetheless. Alright, and some heretics, 2% heretics and 13% pagan. Some remnants, yeah, pagans are basically who believe in the old gods, right? Who are before Christianity, they were all pagan basically, and this is some guys, some old people who still believe into this, but they will also be converted when we build our chapel or send a priest in to convert them. Some heretics also, you also have some who don't want to fit in. We will try to get rid of them as well. So yeah, we have 85% is Catholic, which is resulting into 70% of buff to our public order. This is basically why our public order is quite high. Also this, yeah, is very good. So you may be wondering what this is. So in event of a siege, this settlement can hold out 9 turns if it is being sieged. What I mean by this, if an enemy army attacks but they just lay siege, which means encircling the settlement and just keeping it under siege, I do believe you will understand what a siege is, but I am happy to explain it for you if you don't. But I'm gonna go from the perception that you understand what siege is. So the army lays siege to the settlement, and the people inside, or the army inside of the settlement, and also the people have 9 turns worth of food. All right. So that's that. Also, you have these buttons. This is a very interesting one, and you also can make this settlement at any given time your capital. But no, London is our capital for sure. Yeah. All right. So we can also click this. So we have this tab. We can also click this.
This scroll shows the tradable goods in your settlement, as well as income from farming, mining, and trade with other settlements. Using merchants and making trade agreements will increase your income from trade. Constructing farms and mines will also increase a settlement's income.
All right, she explained it very nicely, but I am going to explain that a bit more for you guys and girls. All right, trade details. Of Cain, the castle of Cain basically. So what resources are we doing on land trade? So we are having some timber from Paris and some dyes, some more timber from Anjou, so we're trading actually with the French, and wine and also dyes. Sea imports we are getting from Lyon, which is basically, I do believe this is Spain. Some coal, some wool, And here we have some fish archers. I have to look on the map where this is. Some fish. Some amber. From Lisbon, we have marble and tin. So we import this and we export this to our orders, some timber and some dyes, which gives us in total a, so this is a trade total, and here we have our harvest, which is also added to it, and also we have our mining, if we have mines, of course, which we don't have, and which gives us a total of this. Very nice to look at from time to time, to see where you are trading towards and what the city is actually importing and exporting. Alright, so we got that explained and learned and under control. So we know basically everything now about this tab. We also have next to that, we have this tab, and here, yeah, okay, you could just do this, you know, if you want, but I want to show you out of this perspective. Yeah, here we can recruit units, so we can levy spears, we can mail the knights, we can do peasants, and we can also get some ships. Recruitment tab. And over here, the big pot of gold, we can look at our finances of our, it's not an empire, of our faction. So we get income out of farming, trade, taxes is a huge one. The king's purse is basically what the king, or what he gives us. Adds to the total finance every turn, and corruption, so we have some corruption, which is our honor, giving us also income. Alright, and also from diplomacy, our tribunes, if we like almost kill a faction and we get them to sign a pact which makes them pay us every turn like 100 gold, yeah, we also then it appears over here. Income from construction, yeah. Our merchants here is also displayed, and our mining. So of course we have expenses, wages, army upkeep is always a big one. So the more units we have, the more upkeep we will have. If you count this, we have this. If you have so we have 4,701 income and 4,243 of expenditure, which gives us a total profit of 458, which will give us a balance next turn of for now it's 10,458, which will decrease because we will do some spending, some money spending, we will build some stuff. Alright, so on this one we have a lot more to look at. We have our family tree, so we have our King William the Conqueror, our faction leader, age 50. Is married to Matilda, which is a bit more younger, almost the same age. We have Prince Rufus, we have our beautiful Princess Cecilia, we have Robert, and we have Henry, King Henry, I hear you say. A Robert the Crusader, I would believe, yeah, and Prince Rufus. Alright, so that is our family tree, which will of course grow. Here we have our faction ranking, so you can click this at any given moment. You can, when it lights up, it's selected. You can click France, and you can look at all rankings. Of course, we did not do any turns just yet, so we don't see anything yet. We'll return to this after a couple of turns. Also, we have our list scroll.
This scroll gives you a summary of your generals and the troops under their command. Right-click on a general for more information about his retinue, character traits, and army.
All right, so this gives us basically everything, all our armies or our ships. This gives us all our settlements.
This scroll gives you an at-a-glance summary of the management of your settlements, their size, population, happiness, and governor. Right-click on a settlement to bring up the settlement scroll.
She sounds quite English. Happiness, she said. All right, I do like it though. yeah, so we have London, we have Nottingham, and we have Kane. Of course, London is our biggest moneymaker, or has the biggest population. Well, this is also quite interesting. You can see what is happening here. We can also, at a glance. Oh yeah, I said it. At a glance, see what's happening here. I see this is all the managed, which I don't like. I like it to be manually managed. You can see if there's a lord or a lord inside of the settlement. You can see how much it makes, if the populace is happy, how many actually, and how many if they have growth. Here we can see no growth, so we have to address that, of course. It's probably caused by this, because it's we have to select a growth management. All right, and so this is also very nice. Also, this is very nice. Amount of soldiers and everything. Yeah. So we have our agents. As you can see, we have spy, region Yorkshire, a trader, and we can also see their what they have, their skill. Our diplomat, our cardinal, and our beautiful Cecilia. All right. Very nice, very interesting, very nice to look at and to learn more about, or to learn how your faction is doing, or your faction, how England is doing, basically. Yeah, okay, so, and the last one here is the College of Cardinals.
There are 13 positions in the College of Cardinals. New cardinals are selected when a position is vacant. To increase the chance of your priests being selected as cardinals, stay in the Pope's good graces and send your priests on converting missions.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, in the Pope's good graces. This is definitely something we are going to try to do, because we are very Christian. God is our shepherd. All right. Yeah, I am actually Christian, though. Just so you know. Yeah. But she explained it very well. The College of Cardinals. Here we have the three. I won't say the big chiefs, the big boys, but the preferati. They are the heads of the cardinals, and they are measured by their piety. So we can increase our piety, as she said, by converting. More people we convert. If we kill heretics or put them at the stake, we also get some more piety. So yeah, that is how we do it, how we get that piety up. The more piety we have, the more chance we are selected to become a bishop. It's called basically a cardinal, but College of Cardinals. There are only, as she said, 13 spots. 0 seats empty, so they are automatically selected at their piety level. Ooh, this guy is naughty. The fungus, the corrupt, so he fondles a lot of money in his own pockets. Alright, so as you can see, our cardinal, we have a preferati, starting with a preferati, which is very nice. So Poland has one, also Venice has one. So yeah, basically every faction is for now represented. Not every, but most factions is very diverse, which is nice. but we'll try to get as many of our guys into the college. Eventually, also when the Pope dies, there will be they will choose a new Pope, and this is how you get your own priest, your own cardinal, bishop, however you want to call it, elected into being a Pope, basically. So yeah, very nice. All right, so that is that. Let's close that. Right, let's actually start to play a game. I am explaining a lot, I know, but I also want you guys to learn about this game because it's really nice, really awesome.
Your orders, sire.
I know a lot of guys are gonna watch that actually already know the game, but maybe it will be a little fresh me up. Because many of you guys have moved to Total War or something else, or Rome, and I like to come back to this because it's quite good. It's an old game. It's I don't know what the release date was, but this is quite an old game, but it still looks quite good in a modern standards. Of course, it's not. It's not looking bad, in my opinion. All right. Of course, I would love to have a medieval tree, but currently it's a bit of a problem with originality in this game. They just reuse everything again, like the latest game. It's basically I believe it's a ripoff of Troy, what they made. So they use the same engine. They put some new mechanics in it, but it doesn't feel or look as new as we got Warhammer. You know, that was really something new. You know, it was really nice, and I hope they do the same with. I'm not copying. Or making from a Attila a medieval tree game, or from a Rome engine, or from what they have now. They create something new and unique, and they make the game also feel very good that way. That is basically what I would want from a medieval tree, and of course more factions, more details, yeah, graphics, yeah. But it's a wish I suppose we will never get or see, so we'll have to wait for what the future brings. But
yes,
yeah, medieval tree would be awesome. But for now, I am going to play this awesome game. It's also very good.
The strength of an army is shown on its banner. The more color on the banner, the more men are present. Any stars next to the army show the command rating of its general.
Yeah. That is also very well explained by her. Again, I'm gonna do some explaining. So, we just clicked our army. This is our army present in the Cane region. We have some peasants, some spears, some longbow, some peasant archers. I'm sorry, not longbow man. Not yet. Alright.
Order.
So, basically, they set us every time they set us up to go fighting something. So I always like to think that they were busy on a campaign.
Sire.
To take this, and we are now actually this army is set to attack this. So yeah, also here we have the same
orders
with our faction here, Rufus. He's ready to assault Yorkshire. It's a little hint, it's a little start me up, you know. You can also choose to get them inside of settlement, but yeah, it's rebels, you know, so you don't. If you would attack like France, you would get also. They would become an enemy. And also, you would get not such good graces.
You can right-click on the Army, Town, and Agent tabs on the bottom panel to access summaries of your armies, settlements, and agents.
Yes. As I was saying, you would not get in such good graces with with the Pope, which brings me to our next one, the shield we also can click, which gives us this, the overviews, our capital, who is your leader, and the amount of generals, the battles we have won, the year we are in, and this is our goal, taking Jerusalem, the holy city. This is the amount of turns we have. Here we can choose to auto-manage everything, to only manage taxes. Here is what the AI can spend or save. Slider, this is if you want to do that, but I am not into that, so I'm not gonna talk too much about it, you know. Alright, so here we have diplomacy. Who you are allied, or who are your enemies, or who are your vassals. Basically, you conquer them and they become your, I want to say they become your bitch, but they become your, you become their protector. It's more nicely said that. You become their protector, and they give you money in return every turn. So yeah, here we can also overview all the factions. Nobody has any enemies just yet, and you can also you don't have to. You get some intel on them, you know, if they are, who they are allied with, who their enemies are. You can maybe, if like France has Scotland as ally, and like let's say the Holy Roman Empire has an enemy, like right here, you can go to the Holy Roman Empire with your diplomat, and you can befriend them, and you can have some help against France, you know. It's basically the way it works. So here we have diplomacy, and I was talking about the Pope.
Religion is central in these times, and the Pope is both the religious leader of all Catholics and the head of the Papal States. You should bear in mind each faction standing with the Pope during your diplomatic relations with those factions.
Yeah, here we go. So, here we have us, England, or standing with the Holiness. His Holiness feels no ill will against England. Very good. And he's a young Pope. He's 40 years old. He will last a long time. Alright, Pope Gregory. Yeah, okay, the Holy Roman Empire did something wrong. His Holiness has found the Holy Roman Empire's faith waning. Ooh. Yeah, bad boys. You'll have to be good. Alright, so, and all the others are just in the same. So as I was saying, if we like attack England, attack France, theirs will stay the same, but we will lose one or two because we attack a fellow Christian nation. This is not what the Pope likes. He doesn't like Christian blood to be spilled, you know. And this will affect your standing. And if you mess too much with Christian factions, you will eventually be excommunicated. You will be they will renounce your and they will not think of you as Christian anymore. And you basically become a pagan or a heretic at that point. And all other factions can then freely attack you. They can also call them at that point crusades against you, which we will go into soon. So it can get you want to stay in his good graces or as high as possible, because we are very Christian, as you know. So we want to have a good relationship with the Pope. A good way to befriend him is to get some alliance with the Papal States, which will increase your standing a lot. Get some trade going with them, It's a real good. It's a really good trick to increase your standing. All right. So, and here we can also request a crusade. And here we can go to Cairo, Anjoua, Tunis, Rija, Vilnius, Cordoba, Iknium, Baghdad, Granada, and Alexandria. We can select these as a crusading destination. Yeah, crusades are really awesome. We don't have Jerusalem on this, like Anjoua is a historically famous crusading. Actually, I believe they first took Anjoua, they also took here something, they also took... we have also the DLC for Crusades, so if you guys want me to show that or play that for you guys, do tell me in the comments. Do also tell me if you want me to play Third Age or some other mods. I will play all of them for you guys if you want, but you have to tell me. If you don't tell me, eventually I also will play it, but if you tell me, I will quickly, more quickly play it for you guys. Alright, so Alexandria is also a famous crusading location. This is actually, I believe, one of the last crusades where they try to take here and go like this to Jerusalem, but I believe it failed. I believe they failed to take it in history. Alright, so if you want the crusade to happen, you get this, but we are too early on in the campaign. So we don't want to trigger a crusade just yet. So we have this also now explained for you guys and girls. We're gonna go back to our own little island and our offshore defense, however you want to call it. Alright, so... yeah, here we have our princess.
Daughter of the Princesses can be married to generals in your own or other factions. Your princess can marry foreign leaders or heirs to cement an alliance. Mm. Marrying a general in your own faction will increase his loyalty. She can also attempt to lure a foreign general into your faction. Right-click on a worthy general to propose marriage.
Mm. Yeah, so she can do a lot of things. She can... all things that she said, so... we can marry a... we can basically... marry her out to another faction to have a marriage alliance, which will increase our relationship, of course, with them. Maybe there's also a chance if she is lovely enough.
Your princess can engage in diplomacy with other factions or propose marriage to foreign generals. Proposing marriage to a general gives you a chance to bring him into your faction. Marrying a king or heir creates a marriage alliance. Marriage proposals from princesses with high charm are more likely to be accepted.
Yeah, so charm actually displays her... beautifulness and also her her cunning to get her the man actually convinced, I suppose. So that's princesses. They are also diplomats of nature, so you can send them anywhere you want and they will negotiate deals. Actually, also they have the more charm they have, the more chance of the proposal working. I am also
where to, sir?
Here we have our spy, so we can send them like over here. Spy on Scottish.
With discretion, sir.
Edinburgh is now in sight, and you see they also have an army over here already. They have quite a lot of armies. We have a diplomatic scholarship diplomat, which will actually try to get some deals with us. So yeah, we have Richard the spy. Subterfuge is actually the amount of skill he has as a spy.
the more selfish, the more chance he will successfully carry out his missions. Yeah, alright, so we have our spy explained, we have our princess explained, and so also we have our priest.
Yes.
Moving your priest into a province converts the population to your religion. Right-click anywhere in a province to start converting.
Alright, yeah. So, as you can see, this guy, this cardinal, is actually a Prevarali.
Use your priest to convert the population of a region. Converting increases public order in your own lands or can incite a revolt in a rival's region. Priests can also be used against heretics and witches.
Yes. Yes, they can. Alright, she explained it actually nicely. So, yeah, priests. Here we have their traits. Every character actually has traits. So, divine connection. So, yeah. Cardinal, also a little bit aggressive. Alright. A disturbing boost of conviction enters this priest's voice when his sermons turn to biblical conflicts. Yeah, these texts are always nice to read. True, he has committed no crime against the law of the land. His self-indulgent ways are criminal for a priest. Alright. He is a bit naughty, this guy. Aston. And he has a good amount of piety. Yeah. Alright, so, yeah, our priest. So as you can see, I am now scrolling just over the land. I have my priest selected and I'm scrolling over the land. And it shows me how much Catholic, how much percentage of the people is Catholic. Without you going into the building browsers and tabs and just looking it up, you can just easily see it, how many percentage is Catholic. Also over here, the areas that are lit, of course, we can see, the others we can't see. So only 8% Catholic of Bruges, which is the lowest. So yeah, we can actually convert our own regions into more Catholic regions, and we can also go into the Islam regions and try to screw them up, try to make more Catholic people over there, which we want to do, which we will definitely do. We will definitely mess with them a lot of, actually kind of purge them from the world, but that is for quite a lot of later on in the episode, basically. Alright. So, as I was explaining, we have our... he shows us how many percentage Catholic this is. So, here we have 85% Catholic in London. So, we'll move over here.
In God's name. Continuing once I have rested.
And he starts converting the people into Catholics. So we have a church, so it should go up nicely. Alright, so we still have left our merchant.
Merchants can be used to trade resources and make acquisitions. Hold your cursor over a resource to show its value, and move your merchant onto it to commence trading.
Yeah. So a merchant in this game has to be on the tradable resource. So here we have dice worth 6 florins a turn. Let's see if we have another resource here. For example, wine is giving us 12. So some resources are more valuable than others. I'm gonna go for here for textiles.
Journeying onward.
Because we don't have any over here, I believe.
Opening a new trade lane.
Alright, we could go over here, but yeah, we're going to stay over here. So, textiles. I believe we are trading now.
Move merchants onto valuable resources to commence trading, or right-click on a rival merchant to attempt an acquisition.
Yeah.
Merchants with higher finance can trade resources for more money and are more likely to make a successful acquisition.
All right. So, our merchants can take out also other merchants, and I want to explain this. So also they have a skill tree, and the more experience they have, the better they, the more money Florence in this case they will generate. So he's been gone too. some early success in this budding merchant's career suggests he could become a true asset. So yeah, this is the merchants. Alright, and we also have our diplomats, which will or can engage into negotiations with other factions. So yeah, we could go straight away for the Papal States, but I guess we will see some French over here as well. Oh well, let's just go for it for the sake of it. So yeah, we're gonna go and talk to the French and see if we can get some common grounds, or if they maybe want to trade with us or something. Yeah, let's go and see.
Approaching their dignitary, sire.
So you just click the settlement or the general in question of the other faction, and the diplomat actually has to go there, and then he has to start negotiations.
Click on the items on the left to make an offer or demand. Your current agreements with this faction are displayed on the right. Consider the balance of the agreement at hand and accept or reject the offer by using the buttons at the bottom of the scroll.
Alright. So, we are now negotiating with this French settlement. And yeah, of course we can bribe them. and then this settlement will become ours. This guy will become ours. So yeah, bribing is a real thing. Next to that, we can make offers to the whole nation of France. So we can offer them trade rights, which is a generous proposal on their part. We could make the offer, but since this is generous, we want to have them pay us some money. Here we go. So we have offer and demand, and we just selected single payment, and now we have to choose how many, let's say 1,000. And you see, now it went to balanced. So now it's an even offer. Now it's a balanced offer. Now we just make the offer.
No, but maybe we should reconsider this again.
Oh, we should reconsider this again. Yes, you should. And they reconsidered, very good on my part. So they are offering us trade rights, and they will give us 820 florins, which is very nice. And we'll take it, of course.
It is agreed, then.
This is agreed, yes. All right, now we can actually do more offers. We can go for map information, but that would be not so much in our favor. We can say we will attack them. We want to make an alliance. Also, this will become will become our friends, but we don't want to basically become the friends. We can do trade with them. All right. So here we have our relations. So our relations with them is not so good. So it's like it's shady, or it's It's not good. Okay. So our reputation is mixed. It's not good nor bad. Our power is pathetic. Alright, that's not good. This is our wealth, and our religion is Catholic. And their power is quite weak also. Reputation is also mixed. Priorities. Sometimes you see here a trade pop up or a expand or something, a war or a trade, or yeah, so it gives you an indication what they want, if they just want to trade or if they are aggressive, or yeah, but now it's unknown. We don't know enough about the faction to have something here. So yeah, alright, and here we see trade rights granted for this many turns. The more turns this is, the more our relation will gradually also increase, because trading will help our relationship, of course. Alright, and we just close the scroll to end it.
We are done now.
Yes, we are. Alright. I believe I almost have everything explained for you guys. So yeah.
Blockading a port prevents the enemy from trading through their port, cutting their income. Your navy can blockade a port by attacking it as you would another fleet. Select your navy and right-click on the port you want to blockade.
Yeah, okay. So ships have a useful feature. They don't have this many useful features, but you can, like, blockade a port, as she says. And it will give the faction where you are at war with less income, which gives them in turn less money to build armies with. That's the theory behind it. But another thing, ships just you could use ships to, like, if an enemy army is transporting an army to your shores, you could, like, use ships to intercept them and destroy them in sea. Otherwise, they are
fleet ready.
Well,
they are
not unuseful, but I don't use them as much. When you are crusading, however, ships have double length. You can sometimes get faster somewhere with the ships than with a on foot. It depends. So that's ships. If you want to make more money early on, you can just scrap the ships. We don't have any, only have shipbuilding capability. Yeah, we're gonna keep them for now. Maybe it's gonna be interesting. We can transport. Yeah, we're gonna use them definitely to transport or princess.
Oh dear.
Oh dear. Alright.
Set sail!
I don't like the way the crew looked at me.
Here we go. She's gonna go on an exploration.
Daughter of the Crown. Yes.
Alright. I'm gonna actually start to play the game.
Fleet ready, sire!
Yeah, I have to.
A fine day to sail!
Indeed it is. I like to explain everything also to you guys, if you guys never played the game or if you want to get started or not. I know many of you will already know all of this, but for the guys and girls that don't know, it's going to be very helpful to get started with this game. Alright, so I think I explained everything for you guys for now. If something pops up, oh yeah, we have missions over here, but for now, we're gonna actually play the game. Yeah, so if you double click, like a settlement you wanna watch, of an enemy settlement. So yeah, it has a wooden palisade, so it has a wall. Which means I cannot attack it on my first turn, so I'll have to siege them. So let's bring some more archers in the next turn. We don't know much about what they have inside of their settlement. Yeah, so if you have this army...
When moving around the map, it is important to be aware of enemy armies.
Yes.
Left-click an enemy army to view its zone of movement. Double-click the army to find out more details. When an enemy army is blocking your path, the terrain will be highlighted in red at the choke point. You must fight the enemy army to pass, or find an alternative route.
Yeah, that is true. Alright, so there are no enemy armies now in the vicinity, so we'll have to make do with this settlement. So as I said early in the episode, so the developers give us like a queue to go with, so for England, this army is ready over here, so we could either go here or here, but the most easy option is, I suppose, over here. So we take the rebel settlements, we don't upset the Pope as well, so yeah. So actually, to do that, you select your army.
Orders.
And you right-click when the sword appears, you right-click on settlement.
As you wish, sire.
And they go march, they are going to march towards it, and they're going to attack it.
When attacking a settlement, you must either have siege artillery in your army or construct siege equipment on the battlefield. Equipment that is unsuitable for use on a settlement's defences is greyed out. The time taken to build is displayed beneath each item. Click the Show Me How button to learn how to build siege equipment.
Yeah. So, now we are sieging the settlements, surrounding them, and making sure they don't escape. This is the defenses we have to overcome. So this also tells us they have 4 turns before the food runs out, and this is what we can now build with our army. So of course we're going to have a ram build. We have 75 build points, so one turn will build us a ram. We don't want to siege them for too long, so here you can see the more rams I built. 2 turns. So yeah, 1 turn, we want 1 ram. Cannot build this because they don't have high enough walls. Also this because they don't have high enough walls. Here we can choose what we do. We can lift the siege and start off, which we don't want. And we can maintain siege. We can maintain siege also for 4 turns, which will actually starve them out, and which will eventually force them to fight us in the field or surrender. So yeah, we're definitely gonna maintain siege.
The siege goes as planned, sire.
Very good. But they have crossbowmen, which are very, very good. They don't have sergeants, however.
Sire.
See, and we cannot reinforce them as well.
My lord.
Alright, it's a bit of worrying.
My lord.
Our lord, however, could reinforce them. It would be not so bad if we, like, took some
orders.
My lord. We could do this. Let's see if the settlement still likes us. Yeah, here we go. You see, we now move out with our lord. And it's changed to this. Automatic.
The number on the top right of the unit cards shows how many of those units are available to recruit. The rate that units become available for hire depends on the buildings in your settlement. Troops are trained in different buildings at various rates and made available to recruit in your settlement.
Yeah. So, I want to show you this. Our construction is now not locked, but queued automatically. And this recruitment also is now automatically queued. We can unqueue that. And now it's manual again. Also, our recruitment now is again manual, which is very good. And so here we have our ballistic builds now. We have military, financial, balance, growth, cultural growth. So yeah, we should go for growth basically, because it will give us more people actually. Alright, so what to build next in this? Of course the throne square we want. So that's how we build it. There we go. I It will take us 3 turns to build it, and it will cost us 2,400 florins, which are deducted from here. Alright. So
orders.
Yeah, we're gonna go and send some reinforcements just to be sure. You can also hire some mercenaries over here. So we can hire some mercenary spearmen and some mercenary crossbowmen. If you are in a tight spot, you can hire them. But we have plenty of forces, so...
Yes, sire. We shall continue tomorrow, sire.
So yeah, that's this region now basically covered. Now we're going to take a look at London. We have King William the Conqueror inside. And is he giving us...
This settlement is a city. Your cities are your major source of income from taxation and trade. You will need to ensure that your people stay happy for your city to function at its best.
Alright, so... Let's see. Let's see if he actually has a positive effect on the city or not. He has torched it. Yeah, you can just, if you want to see.
Command
it,
me,
you
sire.
Just move him up. You see the difference? We now make a lot more money. Alright. So, and again, then you go here. You go here.
The rate that your settlement's population grows determines how quickly you can upgrade it and gain access to new buildings and units. Population growth can be increased by building farms, decreasing the tax rate, and reducing squalor.
Squalor. Alright. So here, this is of course a town. Mines are the most interesting to build right now because they will give us early on coin. There we go. And while we have the cash, we want to build the big ones, of course. Because soon we will run out of this lovely amount of cash, and we will be, yeah, struggling for it, basically. Yeah, we only make 400 and something a turn, so that's not so much. Alright, so Nottingham. We have to also build something.
This settlement is a castle. Your castles will be your unit production centers. Castles produce little income, but the population is easier to keep content than in cities. Castles and cities differ in the buildings you can construct and the units you can recruit. You will need a balance of castles and cities to ensure you can support your troops.
We'll definitely go for the bowyer over here. Yeah, see how that money is. You know, almost have half, 50% at one point.
An order.
Yeah, we're just gonna take these peasants also with us.
As you wish.
We're actually gonna
fighting falsely, sire.
With our
command me, sire.
Our general here, because we don't want them to stay idly inside. Yeah, so this is not giving us anything. So
as you command. I've tried whipping them, sire. Armies,
so basic
your generals can hire mercenaries to fight in their armies, but be aware of their hire costs. To hire mercenaries, click on the recruitment button. The button will be disabled if there are no mercenaries for hire.
So yeah, when you have your lord, actually lord detail, you can also check out their bodyguard stats, attack, charge bonus, defense. They are quite good. In the fight, actually. And also their upkeep, of course. And you also can upgrade them. So yeah, this is a very, very nice early cav. It's better than anything, basically. Now. We can also recruit again things, Welsh spearmen here we have, and when a crusade is there, we can also join the crusade. We need to have like 6 or 8 units to join it. So yeah, what I want to do now is go over here.
We go no further today!
And we
forts
set up
and watchtowers
a watchtower.
Can be constructed by armies that are led by a general. Watchtowers allow you to see into adjacent territories, but can only be built in regions you control. Forts enable the defense of strategic positions and can be built in any region.
So, yeah. We build watchtowers on the borders of our lands to increase our vision, and we can see the armies moving more basically. And also forts, we can put in a strategic position to defend more good. Alright. But of course, first we have to get to the border, of course. So we can build here some watchtowers to increase our visibility or see some incoming ships. Alright, so
orders.
Rufus actually has a town or village that he can assault, Yorkshire, which would be actually battleground for us and Scottish, which they will obviously try to take this first. So we are assaulting this, and now we are going to attack this. They have archers which are going to do some damage, but it's okay. Alright, let's...
My lord.
So you just take your lord, and you just attack the village.
To battle it is then, sire!
To battle it is then, sire.
Maintaining a siege on a settlement will eventually starve out the enemy. However, in this time, the enemy might summon reinforcements. Click the Maintain Siege button to continue your siege, or the Assault button when you have siege equipment and are ready to attack.
Yeah.
To withdraw from the siege, click the Lift the Siege button.
And you know what is she explained it, of course, very nicely. But what is so nice about Medieval 2 and what is lost on many other Total War games, newer Total War games, you have auto resolve, and here you have to fight. You have no auto resolve. It doesn't exist. And this is what's so nice. It's very easy, just auto it. No. It's not the way to play a Total War game. Many people have the wrong idea of this. You need to fight your battles manually. This is the essence, I suppose, of the Total War games. So yeah, we don't have an auto resolve, so we can either to maintain it, we can fight, or we can sell off. And of course, we are going to fight. So when you want to fight, you click on assault.
Winning a battle isn't just about troop numbers. The balance of unit types and the general's command ability are essential. Look at the balance of power and any reinforcement information before committing your troops. The buttons on the bottom of this scroll represent your battle options. Mouse over them to see what each one does.
So yeah, now we have the battle deployment screen. Your forces attack an army of rebels, English rebels. So yeah, Prince Rufus attacking Captain Ashland, and he cannot escape, so if he is routed, he will die automatically. This is what this means. Sword and skull. This army cannot flee from battle, and if it loses, all units will be destroyed. Here we can the balance of power. We have the balance power, army strength ratio, so it's 20 against 9, so we'll win. Alright, okay. Here we have our. I was assuming. It should be this. It should be this. No. Don't. I'm gonna. If I could, I would blur this out. Alright, so we have the choice here to either withdraw. Yeah, no. we can withdraw or we can fight the battle on the battle map. And of course we're gonna fight.
I shall lead our forces into battle, my lord.
Very good. The princes who have done great things are the ones who have taken little account of their promises. Niccolo Marvelli. Here we go. So we can either wait, and then the weather will change, but it's nice weather, so...
Heard men speak well of me because I do not throw lives away needlessly, and I gain victory for those who follow me. I will not use false modesty and deny these things. Indeed, I say proudly that they are true. I will give you victory if you have the guts to fight like devils when I ask it. These rebellious knaves and villains are not fit to breathe the same air as we honest Englishmen. They must all die before dawn comes again. This is a mercy, because they richly deserve the gallows for turning against their betters. And so make your peace with God and any rivals in our ranks, and set your heart on what is to come. Go with God, men! Raise our banners!
That's also something you will see in Medieval 2, the great speeches of the generals. Also something that is lost in the newer titles of Total War. Raise your banners, men. Awesome. Let's start our deployments.
Units, await my orders.
So, as you can see, this is our general over here. And here we have our his bodyguard units. We have our spears. I just press my left mouse button to select them. And I can either select... I press also control to select more of them. Then I press my right mouse button and I drag them over here.
General's bodyguard!
Our bodyguard is gonna go in flank somewhere. His cav, and of course our archers will go behind our spears for now. Because the enemy has archers over here, we have a lot to play with. Here we can send our units into a loose formation. This will make our casualties less. Our spears can go into skildren formation, which is very good against horses because they cannot go and screw them in the back. Alright. So yeah, here we go, and let's start the battle. We're actually gonna go with our archers and try to screw them a bit. Yeah, there we go. All right, and let's just start the battle. Oh, of course, yeah, we're gonna keep that on. I'm gonna explain this for you guys because I'm probably going too fast. So if you press this. It shows our enemies in the green, units in the green, and the enemies will show up in the red. Very nice when you have a big battles. So yeah, just press this. This is if we want to toggle flaming ammunition. It's good against horses, elephants, especially anything big. Also against, if you want to scare them, if you want to give them morale, it basically gives the units a morale buff. It doesn't do more damage, but it is just to make them waver or to make them rout. So that's flaming ammunition. You can.
Units! Units! Cease fire at will! Men, ignite missiles!
Yeah,
units! Extinguish red! Units! Cease fire at will!
Okay, so when they become close enough in range, they will start to fire automatically.
Units! Cease fire!
And you can disable it if you want to save ammunition and if you want to actually control them in firing where you actually want. We're gonna keep it on for now.
Units, fire at will!
This sword with the this sword basically skirmish mode is now active. This means if infantry or anything will come charging at us or come close to our archers, they will run away from them. And if this is disabled, they will stand their ground.
Units, keep your distance.
This is guard mode.
Units, hold your ground. Guard position.
And then they will actually stand their ground. And when the enemy routes, they will not chase after them.
Units, as you are.
When this is disabled, they will not guard. They will chase after them and basically run them from the map.
Units, keep your distance.
But it's if you want a defensive battle, you know, you better keep it on so they keep their positions. All right. This is if you want them to run. You can also double click your right mouse button to make them run. This is formations. This is if you want them to route. This is if you want them to stop. This is if you want them to
assemble the men.
Group. You can also have formations.
You have pressed the group formation button for the first time. This brings up a set of standard formations for groups of units that can save you time and effort. Move your mouse over each formation button to see what it does.
Yeah. All kinds of formations, we'll get into that later. And we can also put it under the computers or the AI's control, which is quite nice. All right, but we are, of course, going to do it manually. Yeah, let's get started, shall we?
By double right-clicking on a point behind them. This can be a useful trick if your men are faster than the enemy's. When using this tactic, however, it is inevitable that you will lose a few.
Yeah, they are very stupid. They charge their archers forward on their crossbowmen, however. Now they are engaged into our to our horses, our general is doing quite heroic.
You do not only win a battle by killing every last enemy soldier on the field, you also win by causing them to break and flee. When a unit routs, the panic spreads, and nearby units may join them. This can turn into a mass rout.
Our men are winning the battle. If we continue like this, we will smash the enemy.
When the cavalry charge, they cause extra casualties due to the momentum of their attack. A cycle of charge, withdrawal, charge causes maximum casualties or minimum losses. Repeat until done.
Our men are winning the battle. If we continue like this, we will smash the enemy.
Sandwich your backs towards them. Yeah, you see if they are facing with their backs towards the enemy archers, they actually get a narrower back, so they have a shield in front of them. The shield actually has a chance to block the arrow. So, I'm gonna go in the full attack right now. There we go. That's a problem. Yeah, that's a problem. Oh, they stay back. Run, boys. I'm actually gonna go for my archers when we get to the wall. Oh, no. Don't take out. Oh, they are very good ones now. I actually kept this place now, but it's the charge of defense.
Is very much in our favor. If we remain true and steadfast, victory will be ours.
Attack!
half the enemy force remains.
One more volley should do it.
Ceasefire! Ah. General flees like the coward he is. Press on! Break the spirit of his army!
Marches!
They are in trouble here. Oh, yeah,
our men have captured the enemy general. Guard him well and make it so he can see us defeat the rest of his army.
Yeah, right, they're panicking. The AI is actually quite smart. They actually went for okay. See now they are firing arrows at our guys over there.
Our men are winning the battle. If we continue like this, we will smash the enemy.
They are being shot dead at the moment. Absolutely stunning. So yeah, the key thing is to take out the archers early. To save you a lot of damage. Some horses sacrifice.
My lord! Our men are in command of the city!
Dying, he gets a bloody. He has a couple of defense, but...
Our men are This is a clear victory that goes to only men of great virtue and valor. Is the fate of all who oppose us.
When you capture a settlement, you have the option to occupy, sack, or exterminate. Occupying a settlement brings it under your rule peacefully, but the people might rebel against you. Sacking allows your troops to loot and pillage, which gives an order and cash bonus, but buildings are damaged and people are killed. Exterminating kills most of the population and reduces the level of the buildings, but brings the population under your control.
Yeah. So, we can, of course, we're going to occupy this because these are English lands. But if you are in foreign territory, you can just do some raiding and you can sack the settlement and just abandon it again. Or you can exterminate the population if you are like in Muslim lands and you just want to, you know, get the settlement under control. You just exterminate a bunch of them and you get some control over that settlement. So yeah, or sack it, you can choose. If you occupy over there, you will have a lot of problems, so you will have to do sack or exterminate. But we are now in England, we are in New Yorkshire, and we're not going to sack Yorkshire or exterminate the populace here. It's good old English folk here, and we're gonna, of course, just occupy it. Occupy a settlement, we gain some florins from it, 40, but it's nothing. Alright guys and girls, I will have to end the episode here, episode 1 of